In this video, as part of our ongoing series on the subject of metal trunking, we're going to look at some of the accessories that you may come across when you're working with this product. So most of the accessories that we're going to be looking at in this video relate to 50mm by 50mm trunking, although we are going to look at some accessories that relate to the slightly larger 100 by 50mm trunking, including a couple that will take that from being something you just use to carry cables into something that's a little bit more practical for your electrical installations. So how are we going to divide up our accessories in this video, Joe?
Yeah, well, we're going to look at the most common and uncommon accessories and what the manufacturer would call them, but also what we'd refer to them on site as well, what we might know them as.
Absolutely, and that's really important because obviously sometimes there's a bit of a divide between what an on-site spark you might call something and what you might have to call it if you ever go in the wholesalers. So it does make a difference. As Jake said, we're splitting those into common and uncommon accessories. So if you think that we've got one in the wrong pile, then by all means, please do let us know. If it's something that you use all the time and we say that you don't use it very often, then please do correct us on that in the comments. We love a comment. And also, we want you to tell us any of the accessories that you think that we've missed that perhaps might be valuable for people watching this video. So which accessory are we going to start off with, Jake?
Should we start with the T?
Yes, I like that. It's a nice common accessory. So we'll bring that in to overhead cam here. So we've got our T piece there, Jake. As we say, it's a very common accessory when you're working with trunking. It's designed for 50mm by 50mm trunking. But if we have a look inside there, what sort of things can we see that are of note?
Yeah, so it's worth knowing that the trunking fits outside the T to be fixed.
Yep.
Examples where you might use this are you've got your trunking at a high level and you need to drop down to get to some accessories, etc.
Yeah, absolutely. And of course, it's worth noting that this particular accessory and this trunking is from Atcor. Other trunking manufacturers have slightly different designs, so you may butt the trunking up and then use a coupler to join the two together. But in this case, as you say, it goes on the outside. And it's really interesting as well to note that if you look at the lid here, you can see that there's no fixing. So there's no turnbuckles in here, there's no screws. Again, this is applicable when you're using this type of trunking. Other manufacturers do it slightly differently. And what's interesting about that is that in order to hold this on, once you've got your trunking installed, the lid will slide up to that point. And then when you clip that on, it actually clips over the trunking lid, and that's what holds it in place. So it's just kind of sprung in place there. We're going to look in future videos at exactly how we connect this together. We're going to demonstrate that. So watch out for that in a future video. Okay, so we'll take that one out of shot. And now we're going to bring in our next accessory. So what are we looking at here, Jake? What's the common name for this?
Yep, so I'd call this a flat 90. Don't know about you, Joe.
That's exactly what I'd call it as well. However, when we look at the manufacturer's website, what are they referring to?
They're referring to this as a top lid bend.
A top lid bend. So again, it shows the value of knowing these different things because you might be talking about the same product with someone and not even know about it, which is super handy, obviously. And again, we can see the accessory inside. We can see the application for this. If we've got a trunking running along at high level and we need to make it come down at the end of its run, down to a consumer unit or a distribution board or something like that, then obviously that's going to be really handy. And again, we just bring the trunking, slide it over the end there, and then bring your next section down, and the lid just clips over that really nice and easily like that. So as we say, that is a flat angle bend, or as you'd call it, Jake,
a flat 90.
A flat 90, or a top lid bend, according to the Atcor website. Okay, so moving on, we're now going to look at another common type of accessory here. You can see that we've got another 90 degree bend, but what sets this apart as being different from the one that we just looked at, Jake?
Well, they give it a different name. They call it an inside lid bend.
Very good. And we'd call that?
I would call that an internal 90.
An internal 90 as well. Yeah, absolutely. And you can see when you look at this, instead of the lid being on the top face there, it actually sits on that inside face, hence why we'd refer to that as perhaps an internal 90 degree bend. And where would you be thinking about using this, Jake?
So that'd be great for if you've dropped down, you're coming against the wall and you need to, the wall, there's a turn in the wall, so you need to keep against that brick wall, for example.
Yeah, that's good. That's a good example, yeah. Another one might be if maybe you're running your trunking up the wall and you want to go across the ceiling. Again, you'd bring your trunking up against that and then you'd be able to run it out across the ceiling there if you're working above a suspended ceiling or maybe even a car park or something like that. So that is our internal 90, or as it's referred to by Atcor, the inside lid bend. Very good. Right, so just when you thought we were done with 90 degree bends, Jake, we're not quite finished yet. We've got another one to go. So what have we got here now?
So I would call that an external 90, Joe.
An external 90. Yeah, absolutely. I'd agree with that. So again, looking at it on the last one, and if we compare those side by side, You can see on this one, the lid was on the inside of the bend, hence that's why we'd call it an internal 90 degree. Whereas on this one, the lid is actually on the outside, and that is why we call this an external 90 degree bend.
Yep.
However, this is called an outside lid bend, according to the manufacturer. So what sort of application are we thinking about for this, Jake?
Yeah, so perhaps you've got some trunking running on top of a mezzanine floor, and you then need that trunking to come off the floor and run down the wall.
Yep, absolutely. Yeah, so plenty of applications for that as well. And again, any place where you need to be able to access the outside of that bend to remove the lid. And again, all of these lids work in the exact same manner. When you bring the trunking in, the lid will sit up to that point just there. And then you can see, if you look closely on here, you've got these little dimples that are on the inside face of the lid there, and that just snaps over the lid and locks into place, which is pretty clever, really. It means it's nice and easy to get those on and off, but it's nice and secure once it's on there. Next on the list, Jake, we've got these little devices. So what are these all about?
Yep, so these are used for joining two pieces of trunking together, and if I was going to go into a wholesaler's and get a couple of these, I'd ask for some couplers.
Now, that's interesting, because again, on the website where we found these, they are referred to as connectors to join two accessories together, not required to connect 45 degree bend, which I'm sure you'll agree just rolls off the tongue.
Yeah, it's a bit of a mouthful, really, if you're going to go and order some of them. Yeah.
Shall we stick to couplers?
Stick to couplers,
Yeah. Okay, so these are couplers, and as you say, if you've just got two straight pieces of trunking that you want to join together, again, you just bring those two together, pop that inside. And again, what's quite nice about this range of trunking is it's got these little threaded holes inside there, which means that you don't have to mess around then with an extra nut on the inside and a bolt on the outside. You've just got the one fixing screw, which again, makes life simple, keeps life easy. And that is something that we really like. Next on the list, Jake, we've got this little fella here. So what's this called?
Yeah, so I would call that an end cap.
Yeah, I'd call that an end cap as well. However, again, you may see these referred to as a stop end. And what's the purpose of this? Where would we install this?
Yep, so when we've finished with our last piece of trunking, wherever that may be, obviously we don't want to leave, you know, the end of that open, so fingers and objects can get in there, we need to put an end cap on the end.
Absolutely, yeah, so it might just finish like halfway along a wall or halfway down a wall, if the cables are passing through the wall or something like that, and we want to make sure that we seal that off, as you say, to maintain the IP rating of the enclosure. So that's another good bit of kit there, so end caps or stop ends, so we'll remember that. And next on the list, Jake, we've got this little fella. So this looks very different to the stuff that we've looked at so far. It's a lot smaller. So what's this that we're looking at?
Yeah, so they're earth straps.
Very good. So where we've got two pieces of trunking that we're joining together, we may well need to install one of these in order to maintain continuity of the metallic trunking system between those two pieces. That's an interesting question, actually. It's one that we'll throw out to the people who are watching right now. Do you install these as a matter of course when you're installing metal trunking, or do you only install it in certain conditions? I'll be interested to see what people's responses are to that. And there may well be a future Q&A video in that, so watch out for that. Okay, so moving on from the earth strap, we're now going to start talking about some of the less common devices that we find as part of our trunking installation. Okay then, Jake, so next on the list, we're looking at these ones that we think are less common, and it's interesting to see whether you who are watching at home agree with us on this or not, but I would say that this is a less common trunking accessory, really. So what have we got here?
Yep, so it's a T-piece, as you can see, but there's a big difference to the other one.
Yep.
The bend is on the inside, the lid is on the inside this time, sorry.
Yeah, absolutely. And when we looked at this earlier, we'll compare them side by side. So if we put those next to each other, you can see there that on the original T that we looked at, you could almost think of this as a flat T, that the lid was on the front there. You opened it up and you could see where all the cables are going to run. Whereas now we've not got that kind of ability, have we, Jake? So again, perhaps we're looking at an application for this. Maybe you've got a trunking just running in a certain direction. Maybe it's running again over a mezzanine floor in a commercial installation, and you need to drop down from that onto the surface of a wall that sits like that. That's when this would really come into its own. That's when that would be super helpful. So the internal T, or as they refer to it on the Atcor website, this is the inside lid T. So again, making sure we're getting those different names clearly in mind. Okay then, Jack, so we'll get rid of these T pieces now, and we're going to bring in the next piece. Now, this is interesting for me, because I've got to be completely honest, I've never come across this in all my years in the electrical industry. I've never seen an accessory like this before. So what's going on here, Jack?
It's a bit like a Rubik's Cube that's not finished, isn't it?
It is, yeah.
It's, so this is a turnover unit, or yeah, as they call it, a change face unit.
Yeah, very good. So again, you can see the benefit here. So sometimes what you don't ever want to end up with is a situation where the wrong face of the trunking is fixed against the wall. So if you ended up in a situation where you had that face of the trunking fixed against the wall, obviously getting the lid on and off would be a nightmare. Fixing it would be very difficult. It'd be an absolute pain to do that. So with this actually allows you the opportunity to go from having the lid on one face to be able to access the inside of there and the cables that are within it, to changing that onto another face, onto the side there. So again, maybe if you're coming down one wall and you hit another wall and it needs to swap its position over, then you've got the opportunity to do that. So again, we'd be really interested in hearing your comments on this. So please leave us some feedback below if you've come across these, if you've installed these, and where you've done so, because that is a really interesting bit of kit. I love seeing stuff that I've never seen before. And it's a reminder that however long you've been in this industry, there's always something new to learn about. So what are we looking at here then, Jake? What have you got for me now?
Yep, so this is a flange, and where do you think we could use this, Joe?
So I'm thinking that would be quite good. If I'm bringing a piece of trunking down to a consumer unit, that would be a really good way of attaching that to a distribution board or a consumer unit. The advantages as well, if we're drilling and fixing with metal screws into there, that's going to help maintain the earth continuity from the consumer unit to the body of the trunking, which is really good. And again, you know, perhaps, you know, we're never going to be able to cut out a perfectly square hole. Maybe we've got a circular hole. Maybe it's just a little bit too big for the trunking to cover. And if we're worried that, you know, we're going to violate the IP4X rating that we need on top of that consumer unit or distribution board, then that might help to sort of, you know, allow us to get around that a little bit. So again, a super clever little bit of kit there, the flange, as you call it. Now, related to this, that's a little bit small, isn't it? We've only got the 50 by 50 there, and I'm sure you'll agree that the busiest point in an installation is where the cables enter the distribution board. So what can we do to kind of make our life a little bit easier when it comes to bringing cables into the consumer unit or distribution board?
Yep, so we could use one of these.
Right, what do we got there?
And this is a bell mouth.
A bell mouth, very good. Okay, so that's what we're looking at there. So a very similar principle, trunking in this side, and then on that side, we've got a nice large opening that could fit into the distribution board. And if we tip that up, you can see we've got a coupler in there, because what's interesting about this piece as well is you can see that this kind of changes the rule on how this attaches to the conduit. So in this case, you can see you've got the fixings on the lid there, which means that you're not going to be able to put your trunking over that. What's going to happen in this case is you're going to have a coupler on the inside. The trunking's going to butt up against that, and then the lid will just go over and cover that section as well. So a slightly different connection method, but you've still got those lips there and the opportunity to screw that and fix that into the top of the distribution board. And we're going one bigger, so just remind us what this is called again, Jake.
Yep, so this is a bell mouth. It's exactly the same. This is just for the larger trunking that we have, Joe. This is for the 100 by 50 millimetre trunking.
Yep, and that kind of flaring effect on there is really helpful as well, because it means that your cables can spread out a little bit,
yeah,
which makes them easier for dressing and routing on the inside of the distribution board, which is really cool. So we refer to that as a bell mouth. A certain member of the team who shall remain nameless this morning suggested that this was called a gusset. So we're not entirely sure what was going on in his head this morning, but there we go. So according to the ATCOR website, it's called a bell mouth. So we've got that one down now. Now, related to that, Jake, we've got another bit of kit here. What we're going to look at next?
Yep, so we've got a reducer. Some people might call it reducers, you might call it something else.
Yeah, I mean, actually, maybe you call it an enlarger. I think it depends on your point of view, doesn't it?
Depends on where you look at it, yeah.
Is the glass half empty or is it half full?
Exactly.
Yeah. Is it an enlarger or is it a reducer? But again, the principle is clear, isn't it? We've got a 50mm connection on this side, 50mm by 50mm for your trunking there. And on the other side, we've got that larger trunking that we mentioned earlier, the 50mm by 100. So you can go from a smaller to a larger or a larger to a smaller, depending on how you're wiring your cables there. Very good. Now, we mentioned at the start of the video, Jake, that we had something a little bit special to look at the end of the video that would kind of raise this up to the next level. So what are we looking at here? What are you going to show us now?
Yep, so we've got some single socket lids and a double socket lid as well.
Okay, so let's see those. So that's the single socket lid that we've got there, and then the double one that we've got there. So the idea behind these is that they're going to sit on top of the trunking lid, on top of the trunking, I should say, and then we're going to be able to fix an accessory onto here, is that right?
That's right, yep. So you can fix a socket outlet, for example, directly onto that.
Well, that is pretty cool. I'll tell you what, let's bring in a big piece of trunking. So you just hold those for a moment. Let's bring in the slightly larger size of trunking. We'll pop that down there, and then we can demonstrate that point quite neatly. Ha! Look at that! So you can actually have wiring accessories installed directly onto the trunking, which I think is absolutely fantastic. That's great. However, that does bring up a whole kind of raft of other issues, doesn't it? Because all of a sudden we've gone from something that's just containment, it's just got cables running through it, to accessories, to now we've suddenly got live terminals in the back of here. So again, we just have a socket sitting on the front there, which means that the terminals in the back are now forming sort of a slightly different type of enclosure, which is going to change our IP rating requirement for this. And in order to help us to maintain the IP rating requirement of trunking, what else have we got to look at here, Jake? So we've got something relating to that IP rating requirement. So what's this all about?
Yep, so we've got our joint covers when we've got two lids meeting up. Like okay. This here, we've cut a piece of lid, so we've
expertly
got those meeting.
Expertly cut, I might add, by
expertly
the way.
Expertly cut, yeah,
well done.
Thank you.
Okay, good work. And of course, what could happen is that we've all been there when perhaps we've not cut things as incredibly accurately as Jake has here. We might end up with a slightly larger gap there. And if we want to maintain an IP4X rating of a piece of trunking or something like that, then this little cap here is absolutely perfect for that, because that can just snap on top of there, like so. And you can see that that has now effectively really covered that gap up. So you could have a slightly larger gap there and still maintain that IP4X rating, which is really quite fantastic, actually. I think that's a really good idea. I love that. So there we go. In this video, we've explored some of those common accessories that you'll find in connection with trunking installation, and perhaps some of those accessories that we'd say are slightly less common. But what are we suggesting is the case if you don't agree with what we've said here, Jake? What should the people
do? Well, we'd like to see comments below. What would you put into the common and uncommon categories? Do you agree? Do you disagree with us?
Absolutely. And if you think we've missed anything off the list, if you think there's a critical accessory or something that perhaps other viewers might just find helpful, then please, of course, comment on that in the relevant section below. And of course, as to all of your questions and all of your comments, we can guarantee that Jake will get back to every single one of those for you.
Thank you for watching.
Again, that is my line.